1994, meeting of the planning board, the last meeting of the year. Say hello to everyone watching at home and wish everyone a happy holiday and happy new year. Regulatorily speaking, that is, of course. First item on this evening's agenda is a meeting, minutes of the meeting of November 15th, 1994. Any corrections or comments from the board?
Mr. Chairman?
Mr. Edsel?
First on page 5, next to last paragraph, I would just suggest the first sentence starting, Mr. Edsel said, that at the end of that sentence, just strike the words, "that there is public feedback." Probably said something about public feedback, but that phrase reads, just so it reads, has difficulty with the whole idea dealing with accessory units.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Page 6, first paragraph, just a suggestion on the next to last line in the first paragraph. End of that line reads, "they are buying property in an inviolate zone," as an adjective. Then scratch the words, "that was."
Mm-hmm.
Bottom of page 6, last paragraph, second sentence, would suggest after the phrase, "regardless of the architectural character," make that a period, start a sentence, "when single-family homes are converted, comma." We want.
Say that one again.
Certainly.
Put a period here, "when single-family homes are converted."
And then lastly on page 7, near the bottom of the page was listing the second list of numbers, number 4 that starts possible arbitrariness. I'm not sure about that word, but I just suggest that we change it to lot size restrictions that may be arbitrary. Although I kind of like the word arbitrariness.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. That's what happens when you give me an extra hour to look at this stuff.
Anyone else? Top of page 7, first paragraph, next to the last sentence, "inasmuch as in many homes." I just say, "in many homes." Any other comments? Your motion?
I'll move the minutes as amended.
Second.
All those in favor, please indicate raising your right hand. It's unanimous. Just for the public's information, the town council did hear the matter regarding the number of voting members of the planning board, and the number of voting members has been increased from 5 to 7. We did have 2 associates members. All members of the planning board are now active and voting members. Next item on this evening's agenda is the list of correspondence. First item is a letter from the town manager to the chairman of the planning board regarding setting goals and a budget, which will be discussed at the January meeting. Trust everyone come prepared to begin discussion on that at the workshop. The next item is the accessory dwelling unit recommendations to the town council. This was presented to the town council at their regular meeting, and they had several questions, similar questions that were raised at the public hearings and during our discussions and workshop. One succinct question was, does the board chairman believe, addressing me by my first name, believe that there's a need for accessory dwelling units? And if anyone saw the council meeting, I answered that as a board chairman, not as a private citizen. There was considerable discussion of lot size, discussion regarding its review under conditional use standard number 4, which requires that there's no adverse impact on adjacent property values, a concern to those in favor of the ordinance. Again, there's quite a bit of correspondence and information from the town planner, major land use laws, and main seminar, one that I would be very interested in attending. I think we have somebody in the audience here who's quite familiar with that. We have a major, we have a Greenways article. There was recently, through COG, an excellent presentation on Greenways as well in the Greenway system. Crisis in the Landscape, forwarded to us from Councilor Cogshell, makes for extremely interesting reading. A letter from the Puputic Club, a letter from C. Gorm regarding the accessory dwelling units, an Environment and Development newsletter of November 94. Again, very interesting reading. Do the Right Thing article, and an article on sprawl. One of these articles deals with the issue of comprehensive planning and land use planning and the lack of effect it's had in certain states, particularly Florida, on sprawl, uncontrolled growth. Interesting reading in light that the state of Maine has followed similar path in terms of its Growth Management Act and comprehensive plan process. I'd like to go back to just a moment. I have a letter from Coleman P. Gorm, who requested, this is regarding the accessory dwelling unit ordinance, and he has asked specifically why the planning board hasn't addressed standard number 4 of the conditional use standards, and requested I personally respond in writing. As he noted in the letter, I am a busy person and elected not to address an individual citizen of the town on a one-to-one basis. I believe that the testimony before the public hearing and the discussion, all of which is on the public record, deals with this specific issue, and as a planner and I may put together a brief memo, but the issue here was a concern about possible abuse of the ordinance and possible impact on adjacent property values, and we felt that the draft that we sent to the council was a good compromise. Under other business, first item is election of the vice chair. With the resignation of the planning board member Judy Lardner, who was a regular member, the vice chair seat has been vacant. We were reminded, I believe, the last workshop that we had all been assuming we had a vice chair, but we were informed that we indeed had not formally elected the vice chair. This chair will continue to be served through January, until January 1995, the annual election of offices will take place. Is there anything else you'd like to add procedurally? Do we need a nomination?
Mr. Chair.
Mr. Edsel.
I'll nominate Stephen Parkhurst to be elected as Vice Chair of the Planning Board.
Okay. Any discussion? Second of the nomination?
I'll second the nomination.
All those in favor, raise your right hand. Congratulations.
Thank you.
You'd be busy between now and the first of the year. So, in the event I should be felled between now and then, feel free to take over the seat. Let's see. The next item on this evening's agenda is a consent agenda. Again, a reminder that this is a process that's been adopted this year by the council in interest of customer service. Items placed on the consent agenda have been reviewed by town staff, and if necessary, the fire, police chief, and the town engineer, with comments passed on to the town planner, at which time the town planner and the planning board chair review the applications, and if they're deemed to be of minor consequence in nature, then they're placed on the consent agenda. All items are considered at once, and they're considered as a single vote.
You can
Maureen, would you like to give us some background on the two items on this evening's agenda?
Certainly. The first one is the Inn by the Sea. They're requesting a revision to their previously approved site plan to expand the front of the building to incorporate the porch area. The footprint of the building won't change, but they will be enclosing the front porch and using that for office space. The board did look at these plans in workshop, and there was a request made to revise the stairs to the porch because they didn't reflect it was actually out there, and the applicant has done that. Maureen McQuaid, the manager of the inn, is here to answer questions if the board has any. The second item is the Meadowview subdivision amendment, and that is an existing subdivision. It's almost built. The board approved it several years ago and then approved revision a few years ago. In constructing one of the buildings, the developer had accidentally used the wrong pin. The new house under construction is too close to the side lot line. The abutting property owner has agreed to allow the lot line to be moved towards them so that both lots will then be conforming as to the setbacks on the side lot line, and they'll still maintain their minimum lot size. So the applicant has come back to the board to ask for an amendment to the previously approved subdivision to correct that error, and there is a recording plat that the board can sign this evening. They've submitted two plans. One plan shows the existing lot line and the proposed lot line. You can tell it's a very narrow pie-shaped piece of land. The second plan shows what would be the recording plat should the board decide to approve it, and Mr. Lydon is here to answer any questions the board may have on that.
Thank you, Maureen. Again, reasonably straightforward and simple items that the board has seen in workshop. Any discussion on this matter?
I should just make one brief comment. I think when this came before us, before I had to excuse myself, because the company I worked for up until last Friday was the company that was handling the subdivision. I am no longer there. I have shifted companies as of last Friday, so I just want the public and the board to be aware that I do not have a conflict at any time from here on.
Thank you. Mr. Edsel?
I have a motion for the board to consider. It ordered that based on the plans and the materials submitted and the facts presented, the consent agenda is approved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Vote unanimous. Thank you. Next item under old business is Dobie public access waiver, a request by Dr. Piper and Mrs. Anna Dobie for a public access waiver for lot U41-12 located off McKinney Point Road, public hearing section 4-2B. I'll let Maureen speak to this in a little more detail. Just the planning board did elect at its last meeting because of a number of neighbors being involved in this situation to hold a public hearing so that we could listen to any concerns that the neighborhood might have. Maureen, would you like to give us a little more background, please?
Sure. Dr. Tiber and Mrs. Anna Dobie own four lots off of McKinney Point Road. Three of the lots are contiguous, and they're proposing to take those three lots, merge them together as one lot, and proceed. They're probably going to sell a lot, but they're going to be seeking a building permit. Because McKinney Point Road is a private road, there's no frontage of the lots on a public road that requires a public access waiver before a building permit can be applied for. So that's what the applicants are before the board this evening, is for a public access waiver. In mapping the lot, they have prepared two passing sites for a subsurface disposal system, both of which are shown on the plan. They have also discovered an RP2 wetland, which is mapped on the site. They have shown on the site a building envelope which is at least 25 feet away from that actual wetland, so there's no need at this point for any kind of wetlands alteration permit. In terms of the public access waiver, they are proposing to pave the first 50 feet off of McKinney Point Road, and Public Works and the Fire Department have both looked at this accessway and don't have any other issues with it. Mr. Vaniotis and Dick Manthorn are both here representing the applicant, and we will be available to answer questions.
Thank you. Prior to opening the public hearing, would you care to make a brief presentation?
Mr. Chairman and members of the board, my name is Chris Vaniotis, and I will keep it very brief because the town planner, I think, explained to you succinctly what the proposal is all about. Essentially, the proposal is to take what were three lots when the Dobies acquired them back in 1966, combine them into one building lot, which will be, excuse me, just slightly over 3 acres in area. It will be 333 feet wide and well over 350 feet deep. Even staying 25 feet away from what we have identified and mapped as an RP2 wetland, there is still plenty of room on that oversized lot by comparison to the 2-acre requirement of the zoning ordinance to successfully site a single-family house. There are two identified test pits, which will give whoever builds the house someday even more flexibility in terms of where the house would be sited on the lot. And the only reason that proposal comes before you is because the existing road which serves that piece of land is private and not public, and therefore a public access waiver is needed. Interestingly, in 1981, as we look through the town's files, that road, which already serves several other homes, was the subject of a public access waiver request for the lots which are identified as 6, 5, and 4 on the plan that is in front of you. And the Planning Board in 1981 granted the public access waiver request, which enabled the construction of the house, which is currently on Lot 4, the one currently owned by, Frederick Yasowa. And the Planning Board granted a public access waiver request for Lots 5 and 6. I suppose the question that might be asked is, why do we need a public access waiver request at all? But in terms of making the lot marketable, first of all, that's 13 years old at this point, and secondly, the plan now is not to do three lots, but only to do the one 3-acre piece. No changes at all are proposed to the road itself, which has been there for many years, and again, is serving a number of residences already. The only proposed change is the 50 feet of paving at the entrance to the road where it intersects the park entrance road. That, I understand from Dick Manthorn, is at the request of the Public Works Director. In terms of the applicant's interests, we'd be just as happy not to pave that if the Planning Board decides that it would be better not to pave that entranceway. I think one board member expressed that concern at the last meeting that it might become more attractive for people who have no business going down the road if it were paved. But again, the Public Works Director, I think, asked for that 50 feet of pavement in compliance with the ordinance. Also on the plan, Mr. Manthorn has shown a typical driveway configuration designed to the town standards. At least one member of the board last time had some questions about whether it would be appropriate to have that wide a driveway entrance, at least if it were to be paved. The applicants would certainly have no objection if the Planning Board wanted to restrict paving of that typical driveway entrance to within a certain distance from the roadway itself. The code enforcement officer has looked at all this and has written to you that with the three lots merged, and he does consider them merged for zoning purposes, this is a conforming buildable lot. The Dobies at this point simply want to make it a saleable lot so that they or somebody else can get a building permit for it. They've owned the land for almost 30 years. As I mentioned last time, they're elderly. Dr. Dobie is 80 and is just recovering from cardiac surgery. The point is, all they're looking to do at this point is to be able to sell what they've owned for 30 years. To be able to do that and have a 3-acre building lot, they need a public access waiver. Perhaps that wasn't brief enough. But I'll be available, obviously, to answer any questions, and would just, if members of the public have some comments that require a response, we'll take that opportunity if the board allows us.
Thank you very much. Thank you. At this point, what I'd like to do is to open the meeting to members of the public. I just ask that you introduce yourselves, state your name and address, and speak into the microphone. At this point, is there any member of the public that would wish to speak regarding this project? Yes, sir.
My name is James Dean, 76 McKinney Point Road. I've been a resident here for a number of years and a taxpayer. The way things are going, I feel that this is what we hoped would happen. But we do have concerns about the road. And one of my big concerns is that if there should be a fire down, say, halfway or down near the end of the road, the fire equipment comes down there, the rescue comes down, and the volunteer people come down with their cars. And the road, I don't know if you've been on it, but it's very narrow and a little bit windy. And I can see a situation where during the fire, maybe someone down further in the street could have a heart attack or some serious thing happen to him. And how do you get them out? The road would be blocked. A couple of Sundays ago, I was driving down Fowler Road, and there was a fire in one of the houses off Fowler Road, one of those short streets. I forget the name of it. But absolutely nobody could get down in that road at that time because of the equipment. So I think that's a concern for the board to think about. Another concern I have, I don't know if it's appropriate to bring it up at this time, but the height of the building that could be built on this property. I would question that, and I understand that you cannot take the highest part of a piece of property and build from that point up. You have to start and get a medium height and build from that point. And I think the height is limited to 35 feet. Am I correct?
I believe so, yes. Mm-hmm.
So I think that's something that should be talked about. I know other residents have concerns about the septic systems and so forth, and I think I'll leave that for them to bring up. But I thank the chairman and the board for hearing me.
Thank you. May I ask you a question before you step away? Would you perceive that the issue regarding road width exists regardless of whether this house is built or not?
You mean the present width?
Yes. Is there an issue there in terms of fire protection and emergency access?
Well, if there were going to be multiple houses built down there, as it is now, I see no problem. But the way it appeared in the beginning, there was going to be four houses built there.
You understand that, and again, I don't want to confuse anyone listening or in the audience tonight, talking about one lot, one house. There are three lots being combined into one lot, and we're talking about only a single-family house.
Right.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
My name is Ed Woodson. I live at 70 McKinney Point Row. And I don't have any problem with this request of building one more house or selling one more lot on that road. My concerns were primarily arose at the last meeting, which was for the first time I heard about the paving of part of the road, and I'm still not clear exactly how far that paving is going to get down the road. My neighbor, Mr. Dean, paced it off and said it stopped right at the rise, which seemed not a big deal. On the other hand, I thought it went further than that. At the risk of sounding like I came from the last century, I really am into dirt roads, and I think it's been adequate. It certainly does slow down the traffic. But if we aren't talking about an improvement that goes very far down, I don't have any problem with that. But I just couldn't tell from looking at the subdivision ordinance and the zoning ordinance just how far it went. Maybe somebody could
straighten it out. It should show in the upper left-hand corner of that plan next to it. It's 50 feet in length.
Yeah, I know it was 50 feet, but I don't know exactly where that measurement point begins and where it ends. I mean, on the face of the earth, if it just stops at the curb, then that's not really a major issue, but if it's going to go down that road very far, then it could be, from my standpoint, an issue.
From the plan, it appears as though it stops before the curve even starts.
Yeah, okay. Well, that's all I had to add. I think it's, as far as I'm concerned, I don't have any other issues. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other members of the public that wish to speak? Yes, ma'am.
I'm Lee Tomation, and I live at on Sunnybank Road. It would be forward of the lot under discussion on the water. And my concern is the water on the lot. It is not standing water. It's a spring with running water. We built the road when we moved into the house in the latter part of 76. And at that time, to build the road, we had an engineer. He put a culvert under it. If some of you have gone down to look at the lot, the culvert was to take care of the overflow. That water flows down to the moors and then underneath my driveway, across my land, and under Mr. Dugas's, my neighbor's lot, out to the ocean. I sent a letter to the town a couple of years ago when Mr. Dugas was planning to build and said that it was very important that that flow of water not be stopped. Mr. Dugas came over and explained to me what he was going to do, and he's been a wonderful neighbor. My concern in all this is that my well is very close to the road. The lot under discussion slopes down towards the ocean. And if there's a septic system in the back part of that lot, that's going to flow through the culvert and right by my well. We don't have the availability down there to tie into the town system. So it is a concern for me. Thank you.
Thank you. Excuse me, ma'am. Before you sit down, one question. You say that Mr. Dugas's property is between yours and the ocean, or adjacent to yours and the ocean?
It's beside my land.
And it would be the last point of which water that drains from?
And then it goes out to the ocean.
You made a comment regarding the a culvert in the road and that mm-hmm. it drained the water. Are you implying that the culvert is now blocked?
No, it isn't. The culvert serves that area of water because it is a spring. And it bubbles. You can hear it bubbling across the street, sometimes more than others. But it is it's flowing water. It's not standing water.
Thank you. Okay. Any other members of the public? Yes, sir, on the aisle.
My name's Fred Joshua, and I live at 85A McKinney Point Road. And I would just like to support what Mr. Woodson said about paving the road, maybe go a step further. I have four small children, and the fewer cars that are coming down just for the interest and just to see what's down there. And in fact, the worse shape the road's in, the better I like it, because then the cars can't go very fast. And so I would lend my support to not doing any improvements to the road, and as far as the driveway goes, it's fine with me if they have a narrow driveway. I don't think that's a big deal. So if the planning board would consider waiving those requirements, which I think Mr. Dobie would also support, that would be a big plus for me.
Before you sit down, I'd like to ask Maureen a question, and perhaps you know. Who is responsible for maintaining these roads, plowing and making sure they're passable?
It depends on the particular road. I assume in this case this road is privately maintained, so you must have some organization that will take care of it.
That's correct. The residents together chip in and make sure it's pay for the plowing and also pay for grading, and I think we generally do that the grading is done at least once a year, and I think, has it been done twice in the past sometimes? Only once, once each spring.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am.
Florence Johnson, 75 McKinney Point Road. I just want to go on record about the other existing lots that Dr. Dobie has. It, as far as I can see, the two lots that he has there do not comprise a buildable lot. And they have said at the last meeting that it would be taken care of in the future. I would like it on record that the two lots combined do not combine to make a buildable lot.
These are two lots that are outside.
On the other side of the of this, they are on the other side of Mr. Yoshua's property. There are two lots between Oliviero and Yoshua.
Our plan indicates a single lot, Lot 3.
And it's not a buildable lot at this point, correct?
I can't answer that, but I won't answer it.
Okay. I just want to be on the record to say that I oppose to it because I don't believe it comprises the 2,000 acres or whatever it is that you have to have for a buildable lot.
Again, just so the record's clear, at least on my plan, and I believe the plan hanging on the wall, there is a single lot. You referred to two lots. I see one lot, and it's labeled as Lot 3.
This one here, Lot 3?
Yes.
Yes. It's a single
okay.
lot.
Now, that's not buildable because it does not have the right acreage for it.
It may or may not be. We're not reviewing that this
yeah.
evening. That's
okay.
a whole separate issue.
But, you know, will they have to have another waiver for that, too?
They would if it were a buildable lot.
Okay. Well, I just wanted to be on record. I don't think it is.
Okay. Thank you. Any other members of the public wish to speak or express an opinion?
My mother wasn't able to be here tonight. I wonder if I could read this letter.
Certainly.
Mm-hmm. I'm Jane Moore, and I live with my mother at 73 Sunnybank Road. This is a letter from my mother. She couldn't come tonight. We live directly back of and below the land in question. Our family built a small summer cottage in 1924. We enlarged and winterized it in 1948. We have seen the pond that lies above our property change from a place where our children skated in winter, not too successfully because it was small, and where occasionally a muskrat built a house. The pond drained into our land and eventually out into the swamp and back of what is now the Tomations. A culvert is under the road and drains the pond a little lower, I think, than in the old days since the Tomations built. We've planted two willow trees and more recently another one that has helped with the excess water. Our concern is the drainage from any septic tank that may be built. We have wonderful neighbors, each interested in the well-being of the other and the neighborhood in general. We hope this will be true of whomever builds on that land. We hope there will be one, not two houses because of the drainage. Thank you. It's been quite wet, you know, when I've been mowing the lawn quite often because of the drainage that we have now. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Can I speak again, please?
Before you do, is there anyone else who hasn't had a chance to speak that would like to speak again? Go ahead.
I'd like to address the paving of the entrance to the McKinney Point Road. I feel that the residents there would like to see the board waive that requirement. And I would it be possible to ask for a showing of hands from the residents that are here?
When we have a motion, we'll go ahead and that'll be discussed as part of the motion, and you'll see the vote at that time.
I think everyone would be favorable toward that direction. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else from the public who wishes to speak? Seeing none, I'll close the public hearing. At this point, turn discussion over to the board. Again, just keeping in mind that we're talking about a single lot, which is made up of parcels 5, 6, and 7. And the total area of this lot now is...
A little over 3 acres.
A little over 3 acres, and the minimum lot size in this zone is...
80,000 square feet.
80,000, or slightly less than 2 acres. So this exceeds the minimum lot area by about a third. Before it gets to board discussion, I would like to ask Mr. Manthorn, one of the issues that was raised was the issue of locations of the septic systems. On our plan, it appears that the septic system is located in the upper third, or certainly above halfway up the property, well away from the southerly property, or the lower property line, southerly property line. Would you just speak to the issue of possible leaching of the septic systems into groundwater and onto adjacent properties? If there are any special ways of protecting against that, and secondly, what the state requires with the design that you've come up with?
In my design, I require a clay barrier at the base of the fill on the downside of the system. It's required that the system be 100 feet away from standing water, and a plumbing code requires that. If the system's installed properly, it should not have any leakage down towards that pond. If it's not, it might. But you do have an excellent plumbing inspector in this town, and he does go out and check those things. So I'm sure that he'll take care of it if there is a problem. All I do is design it. I don't install it, so it's up to the installer to put it in right and up to the homeowner to use it right.
Are you present during the installation?
I am not. But the plumbing inspector is.
Okay.
He's supposed to be there at three different stages of the inspection, or of the installation.
Is there a diversion swale on the uphill side to divert stormwater runoff around the...
There is. You're supposed to divert the surface drainage from the upside around the system.
Okay. Thank you. At this point, I'd like to turn it over to any questions or comments that board members may have.
Excuse me, a couple of quick questions. Is Park Road, is that a state or a local road? Because it's owned, isn't that land that's owned by the state?
I believe up to a point the town maintains it, and then it went, at some point it turns into a state road. But I believe the Public Works Director is responsible, at least to McKinney Point Road, to plow it.
Okay. Second question. I did drive down there once, but it was getting dark, so I didn't notice. Is there a private road sign there?
Yes.
Okay. Let's see. I'm certainly willing to entertain a discussion about not paving the beginning part of the road. I think given its location near a state park, it would make it more attractive to people to drive down there, and I don't think that's fair to residents that pay for their own upkeep of their road, and it is a private road. That's it for me.
Thank you. Any other board members' comments, questions? Mr. Edson.
I'll just say for the record, I'm typically the board member that vehemently requests that we pave the first anywhere from 30 to 50 feet. And the risk of making myself look silly, I think I would support, or I'd rather not see the first 50 feet of this road paved. And I know that's inconsistent with it. It's always been in support of the Public Works Director. I just think in this case, the character of that neighborhood, just the inconspicuousness of that road as it is right now, we'd do a disservice to the neighborhood by paving it and making it more obvious. I mean, to a certain extent, it's not even a very obvious gravel road.
It certainly isn't.
You can miss it quite easily. So I think in that light, I would be supportive of that. Lastly, I respect very much Mr. Manthorn's work, and I think he sidestepped the question pretty well as far as, I mean, he's not the person to decide whether that system will fail or whether it will appropriately handle the material. I am no expert on subsurface septic systems, but there's always a high risk when you combine shallow soils to fractured bedrock to this type of water formation, that something's happening. The issue really is that the state code allows this type of facility. And I don't think the question is answered here at this level or at the planning board to resolve that issue. It's a state and plumbing code issue. And I don't really think there's anything within the jurisdiction of this board that can change that. Otherwise, I have no other questions. I assume from what I read that there's going to be no requirement other than the driveway and certain design to the entrance without asphalt, in my preference, to the access road. That's all I have.
Thank you. Any other comments or questions from the board? I had the good fortune, I guess, of driving down there, and I really had to look hard to find this road. I took the wrong turn to start with and got down on the lower road. And having grown up with camp roads as a kid, I really appreciate narrow and conspicuous gravel roads. The one thing I did notice, however, is the extreme wetness of the entire road right-of-way. And I'd like to ask the applicant regarding the wetland mapping, was the entire site mapped?
Dick and I are both getting up. Are you talking about the, Mr. Emery, the
Along the
site along McKinney Point Road?
Well, actually, either one, but particularly McKinney Point Road.
The answer to that is no. The wetland area that was identified by the code enforcement officer was down in the lower part of the site, and that's where the mapping was done. There was no mapping done up on the road.
There was.
The only wetland that I saw would be the ditch.
The public has already spoken. Let us have some discussion with the. Excuse me, sir. You're out of order. Let us discuss this with the applicant, and then if you have questions later on, maybe we can address them then. Excuse me, sir. You're out of order. If you don't allow us to continue the discussion, I'm going to have to ask you to leave the room.
Too bad you can't hear the discussion that goes on up there.
You can't hear the discussion?
That's the poorest feeling I've ever seen. I need to be in.
Well, just a second then, because we're on the air and this is a brand new system. This should be. Is there someone back in the booth? Is there somebody back
there? Yes,
there is. There is, yeah.
Are you having any trouble hearing the audio?
No.
Can you hear us from back there?
Yeah.
Okay.
Fine.
All right, thank you. I'm sorry, I didn't hear you. Would you like to do that? She has an audio connection in there. If you'd like to. Okay. With any respect, let's move on with the discussion here. The only wetland mapping that occurred then was that which the code enforcement officer identified on site during a site visit?
That's correct. It's the area that's mapped. That area will show some standing water on the lower part of the site, and it just dips just a little bit into Sunnybank.
Mm-hmm. And there was nothing identified in the, I noticed that there's quite a quick rise from McKinney Point Road up to a high point, and then it begins to fall the slope. Everything is so thick in there, I couldn't see into the site and make any determination, but certainly the upper side of that, it was overgrown with white dogwood and seemed extremely wet. But
I'm going to let Dick Manthorn down. I've been on the site once, but he spent more time actually on the site doing the survey.
Could you just, for the public's benefit, discuss the area around the septic system and what I've described along the edge of the road in terms of whether or not it might be wet?
There's the gravel road that goes, it's about 14 foot wide, and then to the, going towards the lot, there is a ditch, there's a small ditch, and then it rises quickly onto the lot.
You're talking about...
It is very thick all through there, but it's certainly not any wetlands up here. It's just, if there is any, it would be...
Excuse me, sir, I'm going to have to ask you not to interrupt. The public has had an opportunity to speak. The applicant is now proceeding with their presentation. Excuse me.
There's a surface drainage ditch on this side of the road, a very small one. But I didn't see any wetlands after that on towards the lot. It rises quickly.
All right. Thank you.
Mr. Emery, I have a question for Mr.
Yes.
Hepthorn, if I could. I'm interested in what Mrs. Tomasian said about the culvert. It looks to me on my plot plan that there perhaps is a culvert down at the bottom of lot 3, which is the lot between the Oliviero and the Yashua property. Is that the culvert that she is referring to, or is there another culvert that is somewhere on lots 5, 6, or 7?
No, I don't show a culvert on that plan.
Is it possible?
Are you referring to the 7.15
Yes,
feet?
I didn't know what
that was.
That's
the distance between the Dugas and Tomasian and the setback to Yashua from the Dobie property.
Ah, I see what you're saying. I was trying to put it together with the right-of-way and perhaps thinking that that was the...
There is a four-foot right-of-way, though, on that border.
Yep.
There is, yes.
That's just the right-of-way. There's not the culvert or any drainage.
No, that's just a four-foot right-of-way down to the ocean.
I see. Thank you.
If I can, Mr. Chairman, I think I can help on the question about the culvert. If you look at the wetlands delineation report that was provided by Mr. Sweet, which we submitted to you in October for the November meeting, on the second page he discusses the culvert. And, yes, there is apparently a culvert down at the bottom of that wetland. What Mr. Sweet says, the geologist, is that discharged groundwater and surface water runoff is impounded in this basin by the elevated gravel road, and a culvert under the road is improperly positioned to drain the wetland. Apparently, when the folks down below built that road, the culvert didn't get in at quite the right angle, and that's contributing to the impoundment of water there. But I don't think that culvert shows on the plan. That's right.
It also may have heaved over the years and has simply
That's right.
risen too high for drainage. Okay. Any other questions? I was indeed the member of the planning board that raised the issue at the last meeting regarding the driveway turnaround. As a neighbor pointed out, or an abutter pointed out earlier, there could easily be a backup of emergency vehicles down here. And we've heard from the neighborhood that there's no desire to change the situation that is presently existing. I certainly don't, particularly given the scale of development down there, don't have any ambitions whatsoever to see a single-family home driveway turned into a major turnaround. However, short of providing some other means of turnaround within the neighborhood, there seems to be a need somewhere here to be able to get a fire truck in and out. And what I would suggest to the board is that we follow the radii that are recommended on the plan, but that the actual pavement be much less than that, just be typical of a single-family driveway, if there is pavement at all, but that there'd be perhaps under some, there would be a shallow loam and seed area underneath that gravel. And that's something that could be worked out with the Public Works Director. I want to speak to the question regarding the height of the house. One thing that struck me quite remarkably, I guess, is I have never been down in this neighborhood, and I've seen so many oceanfront houses developed, whether it's along Shore Road or elsewhere, where and in other subdivisions in Cape Elizabeth, where it just appears that somebody's using a different measuring device today than was used 20 years ago. That is, the mass of the houses is much greater than it has been in the past. Certainly, the neighbors should be aware that the building height is 35 feet, and I believe the measurement is taken from average grade to the peak of the roof.
I don't mean to interrupt you, but technically, there is no height limit in the zoning ordinance in the RA zone. The height limit comes from the building code, and it's based on the construction techniques used to build the house. As long as the structure uses a wood frame construction, the building code will limit it to 35 feet. If someone wants to get a little bit more fancy and use some steel reinforcement, it's possible that the height could go higher than 35 feet.
Scary thought. In any event, you should be aware that is a possibility. I don't believe that this is a neighborhood that has a neighborhood association with any caveats or covenants required on lots regarding home market, the design of houses or the mass or height or commercial vehicles in the driveway. I guess the applicant could speak to that. Are you aware of...
No, there's no restrictions.
Okay.
On those three lots, anyway.
Okay. All right, with that, I guess I'd ask that we have a motion that would address the issue regarding... why don't we just have a straw vote of the panel, of the board, regarding the issue of the paved, the first, the 50 feet of pavement.
Can I just say one more thing about that?
Certainly, go ahead.
I just don't want to end up giving your public works director a bad rap here, so to speak. My understanding is that Dick Manthorn did the 50 feet of paving on the plan because he consulted with the public works director, who repeated to him the requirements of the ordinance, mm-hmm. and the requirements of the ordinance are 50 feet. But I just asked Dick, and I don't think this was a situation where the public works director was saying, I want 50 feet on McKinney Point Road necessarily. So I don't feel that you're somehow subverting the public works director. I think, is that correct, Dick, that he was simply telling you what the ordinance requires there? And again, the applicants would be just as happy without the paving as well.
Okay. I would assume that the, I won't assume anything. The one thing that I noticed was that beyond McKinney Point Road, actually heading down to the lower road, there's a wide turning radius, and the water drains on the uphill side of that and then traverses diagonally through the curve. And there's a lot of rutting and erosion in that area, which could be dangerous on a sharp turn. Those are sorts of things that would be as much of a bother to the neighborhood, I think, having to drive over on a daily basis. So I think it's sort of a self-policing situation down there that as soon as the wheels start to rattle a little bit and the mufflers get loosened up, that'll be maintained appropriately, and larger emergency vehicles can certainly traverse that in an emergency situation. With that, what I'd like to do is first have a straw vote of the board regarding the need to pave the first 50 feet. Anyone in favor of paving it? Okay, thank you. Is there anyone in favor of constructing a paved turnaround as depicted on the applicant's plan with a 35-foot radius and a 20-foot wide driveway? Could we entertain something in the of a gravel base of that same dimension, but if there were to be a paved area, that it would be a radius of no more than 10 or 15 feet?
I have a motion that we could start with.
You'd like to go ahead.
Okay, a motion for the board to consider findings of fact. Number one, Dr. Tybor and Mrs. Ann Adobe are requesting a public access waiver for one lot, U41-12 on McKinney Point Road, which requires review under Section 19-4-2B. Number two, the application substantially complies with the public access waiver requirement, Section 19-4-2B. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Dr. Tybor, and Mrs. Ann Adobe for a public access waiver for one lot, U41-12 on McKinney Point Road, be approved with the following conditions. Number one, the paving of the first 50 feet of McKinney Point Road be waived. Number two, that the driveway radii be loamed and seeded, and the paving, if any, be limited to a normal driveway width.
For the sake of discussion, I'll second the motion.
Okay. Any discussion on the motion?
The only discussion I have is under the term normal driveway width. I'm not sure that that's specific enough, or we don't want it to be anywhere.
I'm not sure what a normal driveway width is, or otherwise I would have put it.
Okay.
Okay. The only other issue that I think we should address is the issue of drainage, and I would request that perhaps we could add to the motion that the culvert at the bottom of the wetland area be cleaned out by the applicant and be sure that it flows according to its
Mr. Chairman, may I speak on that, where I was the person who put it in?
You were the person that put it in?
Yes.
Yes, why don't you come up and address that issue?
We built the road in the latter part of 76. That portion of the road was a gully because it was running water. We had an engineer come in and construct the road. The reason for the culvert, it's not out of line, out of place. It's exactly where it should be, the idea being that it was only to take care of the overflow. So it was as high as it could possibly be without washing out the road.
Is it, in fact, clear?
It's clear. It's clear. It's running. And as far as the septic system is concerned, that lot goes downhill. Now, water, as you know, goes downhill. It's going to go into that spring water. It's going to come through the culvert right by my well. And there isn't any way that I'm not going to have a contaminated well. The problem is that the three wells were drilled on my property. I have valuable property. And that was the only place that we could get water. So if my water is contaminated, I don't have any value in my house at all. So you can understand how very concerned I am. And to put a septic system in the back, it's going to go right down into that area. I mentioned before, I'll mention again, this is not my imagination, because 2 years ago I wrote to Mr. Daigle about the spring and about the running water. So it's on record that that's exactly what happens to it, that it goes through the culvert, down my driveway, through another culvert, and then out to the water.
Thank you. Let me just rephrase my what I'd like to add to the motion, then, is that the septic systems are installed according to code, designed and installed according to code, and that the applicant with the code enforcement officer investigate the site and be assured that they are placed away from any springs or standing water according to state code. Now, I've got to believe, since the applicant's representative is here and is a licensed engineer, that that has already been done, but out of concern for the abutter, I'd like to have that double-checked. Again, as Mr. Edsel pointed out, this board is not in the position of enforcing septic system laws. That comes under state jurisdiction and the town's code enforcement officer.
Just for the board's information, the applicant has shown two possible septic system locations on the plan, but the fact is, if someone purchases this lot and designs a septic system elsewhere on that lot that meets the town sewage ordinance, it can be relocated. So if the board is concerned about the septic systems actually moving closer toward the wetland area than they currently are, you may want to consider that in your motion.
Mr. Chairman, if I can, I think, as Mr. Manthorn said, it's a 100-foot setback from standing water, and the southerlymost bed, as it's shown, is about as close as you can come to 100 feet without getting any less by my scale rule, my BIC scale rule. The planner is exactly right. It can be placed anywhere, but we're still under, and I don't know that this board has any jurisdiction to increase the 100-foot setback, since it's not part of our ordinance to require that. I've long been sympathetic to the inadequacy of state plumbing code, and this woman's concern and fear is certainly justified. But the point that I made before was that there's nothing that I can see in the jurisdiction of this board to change that, other than make sure that it complies with municipal and state plumbing code.
Which is the code enforcement officer's realm. Okay. Mr. Parker?
Do we have the power, or whatever the correct word is, to limit where the septic site can be located, as to which half of the lot or something like that, to keep it away from some possible water flow?
I don't believe so. I think that's really, again, it's up to a state and local law. And to sit here with a plan that is not a topographic plan and make a determination because it's horizontally farther away may actually be selecting the poor of both sites.
I understand that, but it seems to me that someone who has been on the site and knows the site and knows the water flow on the site should be able to determine which is going to be the safest location for a septic system to address the problems we've been hearing tonight. And I think the only person that might be able to do that tonight is Mr. Manthorn, since he designed the systems and knows the site. Would it be appropriate to ask, at least?
Certainly would be. Again, I don't want to throw out the baby with the bathwater here. We may end up with a situation where there's a marginal difference in the two septic systems, and yet there's a preferred building location because of possible obstructing the views from the uphill side. But would you just address Mr. Parker's question?
This plumbing code's been in effect since 1974, and everybody concerned with it has gotten better since then. It's been in existence for 20 years. The malfunction rate has been cut down to less than 5%, according to the state records. I can't guarantee that it's going to work because it's based upon the use, it's based upon the installation, but you do have an excellent plumbing inspector here who will check that out thoroughly. I do have a clay barrier put there that is not required by the code, and a clay barrier does help stop malfunctions on the downside of a system. So, in my opinion, if it's installed properly, I think it'll work fine. And all it has to be is 100 feet away from the standing water. In my years of experience have showed me that that's probably twice what it has to be, because if the system's working properly, that sewage cleans up within 5 to 10 feet. The only thing that goes further than that would be phosphates and nitrates, and they seem to be up to 50 feet. I don't think it's necessary to even be more than 50 feet from a wetland or a water body. State requires 100. That's why the system's 100 feet back.
You wouldn't at this time suggest that there's a preferred location, shown the two sites that are on the plan. One is one a preferred site to another?
I don't think so. I think the soils are about the same. I was actually surprised to find as much soil as I did on that property.
Okay. Mr. Edsel.
Question, Mr. Manthorn. Would you recommend 2,000-gallon septic tank set in series if the dwelling has garbage disposals in the structure?
I don't recommend garbage disposals because it grinds it down too fine and it causes problems in the septic tank when they eventually go out into the field. Right. I'm not so sure that a 2,000-gallon septic tank would correct the problem, though.
I would agree with you, but that's the terminology and the description that we see fairly often.
Time through 1,000.
As you say, the particles are macerated too fine.
That's right.
Finally, those particles go out into the chamber, and the chamber gets choked, and all of a sudden you don't have a chamber system. You have the old-fashioned leach pipe.
Yeah, they don't seem to settle
right
in the sewage that's in the tank, and I don't think the three-day through the tank, which is in 1,000-gallon, compared to a six-day in a 2,000-gallon, is going to make any difference. I think they're in colloidal suspension as it is.
Concern comes up. Yeah, how often do you see a home now without a garbage disposal? And the rates that you suggest of 5%, and I think that's a 5% failure rate in its expected lifespan, which is a guesstimate at best, probably 15
between 10 and 20 years.
10 and 20, 15 and 20. At 15 and beyond, that rate goes higher. It also doesn't take into account if there's a garbage disposal. And all said and done, I mean, that's always been my argument against these disposal systems, but I don't know that there's anything that this board can do that says, no, you can't have a septic system on this site.
The only thing that I can think that we can do, and this is perhaps a bit of a hardship, given it's a single-family lot versus a commercial use, but in other situations where we've been concerned about water quality on adjacent properties, we've asked that the applicant contribute or provide, in this case, it was the owner of the property, so it's a different situation, but provide water quality tests. I don't know if the board wants to suggest that, but I certainly, at a minimum, would suggest that the owner of the Moore parcel, or anyone who feels that they'll be affected by the downstream flows of stormwater, have their water quality tested before construction starts and before the installation of the septic system, if it is eventually installed, so that you have a benchmark for water quality prior to construction and then prior to use of the septic system. Does the board have any interest in having the applicant contribute to the cost of such testing? Maybe a little out of order.
Well, just a quick question. How much does it cost to test? Well, I don't typically do that.
Do you have any idea?
No. I mean, it depends on the sophistication of the test, how many tests, if we're talking about the tests that were required by the In by the Sea, what that probably runs, $400 or $500 a year.
Just to interrupt the board, I do remember that the board required that the pond just north of Woodland Road for the Rosewood subdivision be tested, and I remember being told that that was $200.
Right.
And that was a one-time test of 5 different parameters.
And I'm just trying, if I can, through the planner, who is accountable for the testing of that?
In that case, we required the applicant to do it, and he submitted the test. But as I remember, he was actually pleased with the idea because he felt it was going to protect him in the end, because he had baseline data of what the quality of the pond was before he went in and did his development. He felt that what he was doing was not going to have any impact on the pond, and therefore having the tests before he did the work, he felt was going to protect him afterwards.
Would the applicant have any objection to providing such data?
I guess I have to ask the board precisely what the board is looking for. I'm at something of a disadvantage because my clients aren't here tonight. Are we talking about the water quality in that wetland area itself, or are we talking about testing of people's wells?
I think realistically what we're talking about is the quality of the water in the wetland itself.
Yeah, I guess the problem I have from this applicant's perspective is at this point we're not even proposing to install septic systems. I mean, we're here for public access waiver, and somebody at some point presumably is going to build a house on that lot. I guess I can't say yes to that in terms of knowing that my clients at this point would agree to that ongoing obligation on a lot that frankly they hope to sell. And I guess I'd only suggest to the board that I understand your concerns and the neighborhood concerns, but I think that is something that is appropriately left to the plumbing inspector and the plumbing code when we cite one single family, or when somebody cites one single family house on this lot. And what we really need to be talking about is the road. We provided the septic tank, the test pit data and the wetlands data to show you that that's a buildable lot. But I think it makes sense to await a specific proposal for a house. I mean, somebody may come along and buy that and decide to put on a small one-bedroom house that has almost no impact in terms of...
This board does not have the luxury of reviewing single-family home applications, whether they're big or small. I guess the best example I can think of is that when there's blasting done on adjacent properties, people often discover all of a sudden all these damages to the foundations that are 75 years old and older. And oftentimes I'm a bit suspicious whether they're new or old cracks, and the best way of dealing with something like that is establishing a baseline data. The board may consider doing something such as asking that you place a condition on the sale that the person buying the property then, if you as the seller aren't interested in doing it, that someone provide to the town and to and then for the public disclosure, the water quality in the wetland, it seemed, as was discussed earlier, that would be a real good lease cost insurance for either you or the eventual property owner against.
I guess my question is, what's the measure of the water quality in the wetland? I can understand that you can measure somebody's well water quality in terms of determining whether it meets drinking water standards, but, and this may just be ignorance on my part in terms of knowing what the board is looking for as to the water quality in the wetland.
You wish to speak to that?
Not that I speak to that, but the issue is, how specific do the conditions become? Are we requiring testing for fecal coliform, nitrates, which types of nitrates, phosphorus, the whole spectrum of testing. To get a, if the concern is truly for well water, then all of those typically need to be done, with fecal coliform levels being the most important. I guess the issue in my own mind's eye is, set the condition, what can be done, or what happens if the coliform count skyrockets. It appears that, and I will ask the council of their knowledge of the culvert appears to be in the easement across the ownership in fee of the applicant.
That's my understanding,
and
yes.
And that has just been the neighborhood way to put that culvert in.
I understand it, as the lady in the audience indicated, the road was actually built by people on the southerly side.
Is there anything mentioned in the easement about the...
No, not in the deeds. There's nothing in the easement deeds that refers to that at all.
Do you know where the culvert is exactly, Mr. Vaniotis, on the plan?
No, I'm sorry, I do not. It's somewhere down at the bottom of the wetlands, but it's underneath the road. Mm-hmm. And apparently Mr. Manthorn didn't come across it, but when the wetlands delineator, the geologist, went out there and did what he had to do, he became aware of the culvert as one of the reasons there was water ponding on the lot.
My concern, Mr. Chairman, is that the wetlands is a neighborhood treasure. It happens to be on somebody else's property at this point in time. If it becomes a problem, then the resolution of the problem is, as the geologist says, that the culvert's not properly positioned to drain the wetlands. And my understanding is, all being on fee title, they would change the culvert location and drain the wetlands. You no longer have any standing water. Would resolve the issue of contaminated water.
I'm not, I think the applicant probably has more expertise in this, but I think at that point you're into drainage easements issues, and we've got a historic situation here that if it's suddenly altered could have impacts on the downstream runoff and so forth that may not be as simple as just altering the culvert. And I know that the Army Corps frowns on changing even let's call them MDOT wetlands, that wetlands that have been created artificially, but which have become wetlands and have had some history of having been wetlands are not as easily altered, although this one isn't very large. The issue with respect to the water quality of the wetlands, to get back to the discussion, is not so much impact on the wetland itself, but as an indicator in the change or any leaching from the leach fields into the surface. I mean, that would seem to be the first place one would find it, perhaps even before you'd find it in the groundwater. I may be wrong there, but that would be the only reason that I would suggest doing it, rather than getting into everybody else's private property issues with respect to well water. I guess if I were someone building this lot and I was concerned about future claims against an uphill impact, I would want to know what the water quality in the downstream wells are. And I would also add that this is not the only lot that's on the uphill side here. We have lots farther uphill here, and we also have similar conditions on both sides of this property. So this is nothing unique to either the development of this house or this lot. It's an issue throughout this subdivision, as well as throughout many of the coastal developments in Cape Elizabeth, where one has a sloping situation toward the shore. With that, how would the board, entertain amendment to the motion requiring any testing of the wetlands?
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Mr. Carlson.
My question on that and setting a benchmark is that if the water does go bad downhill, now the onus is on, is it the new well or the new septic system, or is it someone in the neighboring area, as you just mentioned, uphill, whose system has gone bad? I don't know how old some of these systems are, or even if they're septic systems, and there may be cesspools or whatever up there. And putting that hardship on the new property owner of being responsible for the person's water downhill, I think that's pretty tough.
Well,
Mr. Chairman, may I speak on it?
Does the board have any?
Yes, I'd like to hear.
Yes, go ahead.
We're talking about a unique situation because my well is placed towards the road. Had to be placed there. Would have been much better had it been closer to the house. Mr. Yoshua would be my closest neighbor on the hill, and his septic system isn't anywhere near where my well water is. So the only issue here is that particular lot with the water flow. Now, if it was a lot, and it was a buildable lot, and you could build a septic system in it, obviously it would have an area to leach. But because of this spring, and because it's running water, and the overflow from that lot comes right by my well, so you're really asking for problems if that septic system isn't built properly. And as far as draining, you know, why would you drain someone else's land? I mean, would I drain their land onto my land? So draining it isn't a solution at all.
Would you please point out where your well is on the plan?
Okay, about right here.
That's just below and to the left, yeah, of the lowest point on the wetlands?
And the culvert is right about there.
It's up in the upper right-hand corner of your lot, in the northeast corner?
Right. And the culvert is right here.
Right opposite. There's a little part of your lot that abuts, well, the road is really not drawn here, but a little part of your lot that abuts lot 5. And most of your lot fronts on the Yoshua lot, which is lot 4.
That's right. It's only a small portion that's on the the lot that's in discussion.
And the culvert is right close to your well.
It'd be across the road and down, I don't know, maybe 15 feet. Mm-hmm. And it's that running water that's the concern. And there isn't any place for it to go. And the reason the culvert was high, again, was for the overflow. We weren't interested in draining that lot at all when we put the road in. We were just interested in having the road not wash away. So the culvert was set high, and it does run. As a matter of fact, now is an excellent time to go down and have a look, because the leaves are off the trees, and you can see how much water is there. You can see where the culvert is, and you can see both sides of the road.
Mr. Chair?
Mr. Chairman?
Just a minute, please. Mr. Carlson?
I understand what the problem is. I just think that the approval process of the septic system will take this into effect. What we're here tonight is the waiver for the access to the property. We are not, there are certain, the plumbing officer and other officers in the state codes that will come into effect, and whether a septic system can be put in there or not. I think we were going to go on for quite a while here trying to be who we should penalize if something goes wrong. So that's my feeling.
Thank you. Mr. Vaniotis.
Mr. Manthorn just asked me a question which I think might be helpful to the board, and that is whether the well that this lady is concerned about is a dug well or a drilled well. If it's a drilled well, as I understand it from Mr. Manthorn, then we don't have to be particularly concerned about surface water runoff.
It's a drilled well. I don't know about not being concerned.
I think Mr. Carlson's point is well taken. The reason I have dedicated so much time to this discussion is always an issue with respect to new development and adjacent properties. But you're absolutely right. This is something that's in the purview of the code enforcement officer, but I think we have an opportunity here to hear the abutters' concerns, and it's a good forum for raising all of those. Mr. Edsall?
I guess as the person who seconded the motion, I'm not sure that I'm in favor of seconding an amendment for testing, either benchmark testing or annual testing. There are so many things that come into effect. You know, if new occupant decides to overly fertilize their lawn and with a heavy rain shower, the nitrates, phosphorus goes way up. There are all kinds of things other than septic system issues that can come into play there. And I think we're maybe overstepping our bounds there. I think, again, Mr. Carlson's point is well taken. There are state and municipal ordinances and laws and codes that guide that and govern that. Many times we wish we could do more about that, but it is simply not within our purview.
Okay, so I don't, Ms. McKay.
I agree with both with Mr. Edsall and with the other people who have suggested that we really are bound by the code enforcement officer's finding that the proposed septic system is acceptable under the code and that a plumbing permit would be issued. I guess I also, though, would like to suggest that a possible third condition to the motion might be a condition that the, because the septic system issue has been raised here, a suggestion that the septic, that whoever it is that goes for the building permit take all reasonable measures to assure that not only the minimum standards set forth in the code are met, but that, I'm being too wordy here, that all reasonable measures be taken to assure that there is no infiltration from the septic system.
But isn't that really up to the code enforcement officer and the plumbing inspector to make sure that all reasonable measures have been taken?
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. So I guess I don't have any feelings about that as a condition, but it seems to me sort of unnecessary and onerous for the applicant, because it has to be taken care of by the plumbing inspector and the code enforcement officer. The time of building permit is, you know,
well,
taken out. And
I guess my response to that is that Mr. Manthorne has designed a septic system here just to show that it's a buildable lot that has something in it, namely a swale on the uphill side that is more than what the plumbing code requires at this point. And Maureen's position is well taken, that the, you know, whoever it is that goes for the building permit may put a septic, or may show a proposed septic system in an entirely different place and a different kind of septic system.
And we have not, we cannot do anything about that, from what I understand.
That's correct. In light of that, and in light of the issue regarding water testing, I think it would we're not in a position of offering advice, certainly, but it would seem to be a good approach that people quantify what their conditions are today and let the code enforcement officer know what that is. If people wish to have their water tested, do so. Simply from the standpoint, if there's any change in that over the next several years after construction, you would certainly have a basis for some discussion. Hydrogeologists are generally the ones who are involved in studying and determining the sources of pollution and the nature of the pollution and the nature of the impact. And that's something that would certainly be in the future in a situation like this. Mr. Carlson?
One other comment on this piece of property is that the person who does eventually build there has a problem too. Where does he put his well? Remember, if the septic system is going to go up near McKinney Point Road, he likely is going to be also downhill from the septic system. So it's more to just the septic system here. It's also by code and by state law where that well can be located. Thank you.
And I guess ultimately the issue here is that the neighbors will continue to keep a close watch on this parcel, assuming that we pass the public access waiver and to and stay in touch with the code enforcement officer through the process. With that, I didn't hear any decision to add a third motion, a third condition. So we still have the two conditions. Any further discussion? Mr. Wilcox.
Regarding the second condition, my first take on this large expanse of gravel which seems to be developing was to research the turning radiuses that we've approved in the past on public access waivers. Mm-hmm. We have approved smaller radiuses of 25 feet or even less, but only when the road adjacent has a wider, a 22 or a 20 or a 24-foot road as opposed to a 14-foot road. It seems I have a real concern that, that what we're doing here is waiving something that we have required on numerous applicants in similar situations. I can think of behind Lions Field or on Peebles Cove Road, on similar dirt roads all over town, and that we are waiving something that was in those cases a public safety concern, and I would see as public safety concern this application also.
I think realistically, we're not waiving the requirement. We're just asking that that the 35-foot radiuses be provided, but that they be gravel and planted in grass, and that the paved area or the eventually graveled area be something less than that. I think in order to get construction vehicles into the site, to get a front-end loader or an excavator down in here on a piece of equipment, it's going to take a reasonable radius to get into that site, and it'll be probably about what you see here, given the very narrow width of the road.
One of the discussions on a Peebles Cove site that was very similar to this was snow storage and movement of fire trucks in the winter. Can mm-hmm. you see how this a normal driveway radius would allow passage of emergency vehicles in the winter if
as long as the
site and there were snow banks there?
As long as the area is cleared the full 35 feet, which can be a condition of
approval,
okay.
I would be difficult to enforce.
That would be something that I would look for in a condition before approval.
Not to go against anything that the Public Works Director or the Fire Chief would recommend, but this is not the first house in this neighborhood by any stretch of the imagination, either on this street or within the overall neighborhood, and suddenly to have in the middle of no place a 35-foot turning radius when the last house on the street's going to catch, you know, could catch fire. I just don't understand. You know, if this were the last house on the street and I could understand all of this, but I don't understand how this is any different than any other house on the street, and either an improvement is made down the road on somebody else's property. But I think the issue regarding maintenance is a difficult one, but I'm quite satisfied with the idea of a 35-foot turning radius in gravel overlain with grass and then a paved or gravel driveway of something smaller than that.
I think as long as that loam over gravel.
Have you been to the site?
Yes, I have.
Okay. Any further discussion, Mr. Edsel?
I think we only need to clarify in that light. Mr. Parkhurst may, as long as it's clear to him what the, why don't we just have that second condition reread? And perhaps the planner can read that so that we can clarify that to make sure that it is graveled. The 35-foot radius is graveled. If that's the intent of the person making the motion, but that the driveway area, I don't know how to phrase that, but the improved driveway area.
What I've got is that the turnaround be loamed and seeded, and that the driveway width be limited to a normal driveway width. I would suggest that we take normal driveway width and put a number in there.
I would suggest this, that the, what does the first sentence say again?
That the turnaround be loamed and seeded.
And have a gravel base and be... And that the driveway be a normal driveway width, typically 20 feet.
The current plant shows 20 feet.
Mm-hmm.
So you would want the driveway, it's, the actual road is 14 feet wide.
It can be 10 to 20 feet, that's the range of a normal driveway.
Why don't we say no more than 20 feet?
Okay. Just, you know, a real number helps.
Mm-hmm.
This community does have three-car garages with three-car width driveways, so you're right. Is that all right with you, Mr. Parker?
That's fine.
Okay. Any further discussion? Okay. We have a motion's been seconded. All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Once again, I'd like to thank the public for comment and encourage you to continue to keep a vigil on this project. Could I ask the public to please, if you're going to continue discussions, to please clear the hall quickly, because we do have another applicant before the board. The next item under new business is Elizabeth Heights site plan extension, request by the First Atlantic Corporation for a one-year extension to January 22nd, 1996. Site plan approval for Elizabeth Heights Permanent Care Project located on Scott Dyer Road. Site plan approval extension, section 19-2-10. Just quickly for the board, Maureen had originally placed this on the consent agenda. Given the number of abutters that were involved in the site walk, given the length of time since they were last before the board, I felt it was appropriate to allow an opportunity for the applicant to come back before us and explain where they are in the process and bring us up to speed. Any further comments?
Mr. Coffin is here to answer any questions the board has.
Okay.
I'm Charles Englehart. I'm the architect for First Atlantic, and Mr. Coffin's here is First Atlantic. We're requesting an extension of the site plan approval, essentially so I can get the drawings finished.
Mm-hmm.
I'm in the process of doing the drawings. I brought a roll of drawings so you could see. I have met with the building inspector in the town to get coordinated in terms of construction types and all the various those parts. I've met with the state fire marshal in order to develop construction types and that sort of stuff with him. And the state fire marshal is also responsible for compliance with the Americans Disability Act, which doesn't cover apartment buildings, which is essentially what we're doing. So then we went over to the Human Rights Department, and they said, wow, we really should tell you something, but we're not sure what to tell you. Eventually got through them and got what they think I ought to be doing, and now we're in the process of developing our mortgage package through Housing and Urban Development and getting all of those guys to agree as to, wow, what we ought to be doing. So I am honestly working at it, and we're requesting an extension just so I can get my plans finished, and I can't get the plans done by next month and do a proper job of getting drawings done. So
you're with Gowron Architects?
No, I'm Charles Englehart, architect. I'm a different architect than originally did it.
Uh-huh.
But I'm doing what I haven't changed anything. I'm just developing the drawings.
Okay. Any questions of the applicant by the board?
Yes. Oh, excuse me. Go ahead.
No, I have an applicant, a question. Being new to the board, quickly, how many extensions can one grant? Does this go on? I mean, this will be 5 years if we grant to 96. And I'm just wondering, is there a limit?
Ask Maureen to address that.
This would be the first extension that would be granted for this project. And the reason for that is, when this project was approved, there was no limit on the how long a site plan approval was valid for. A year ago, in a series of technical amendments, the council did establish a limit of 1 year. And for projects that had already received approval, their approval was good for one more year. So even though this was approved in January of 91, the actual limit, time limit on the approval is February of 95. And so this would be the first time they had requested an extension. The board can determine the length of the extension. Typically, the board has approved a year. You are not limited on how many extensions you can grant. In past practice, the board has typically been reluctant to grant extensions in excess of 2 years from the first request.
Thank you.
Any other questions of the applicant? I'm sorry, I still didn't catch your name. Would you?
Engelhart, Charles Engelhart.
Charles Engelhart. Are you on your own?
Yes, Charles Engelhart Architects.
And are you in the Portland area?
No. My office is in Virginia.
Are you licensed to practice architecture?
For sure. I wouldn't have the courage to stand here and use that word if I didn't have a license.
Well, we have a licensed architect from the state of Maine on the planning board, so for his sake, I wanted to ask the question. I will, rather than ask you, I'll ask the representative of First Atlantic, are the plans indeed the same plans that were reviewed and approved in terms of the building design and...
Yes, they are. The site plan is not changing. The facade of the building is not changing. It's the details that were approved back in January of 91.
Would you do at least me a favor and submit a copy of your progress construction drawing showing the elevations and the plans to the town planner so that I can review them and have some assurances that they are consistent with what was previously approved?
Yes, we can do that.
Okay.
I guess I would like to say, for one, that it disturbs me that site plan approval was granted in 91, and we're up to January of 95 and thinking about another year. I presume that you were at least on notice, if didn't have actual knowledge, that the town had passed this restriction last year.
Yes.
And I guess I would like to say that there is a reason for that change in the law, and that is to encourage people to ask for what they want and then go ahead and ask them to do it. This has been quite a long time, and you're asking for another year. Is that actually what you need to have?
We believe it is. We have had a meeting with Maureen O'Meara and Ernie McVane back a number of months ago, really hoping to have the plans completed by the expiration of the site plan date. And because of the architectural drawings being more extensive than what we had anticipated, and also because of the type of financing and the constraints that they're putting on the type of construction, it's just a much lengthier process than we expected. Charlie's hoping to be completed with his drawings 2 to 3 months from now. It's it's a three-story building. With steel, and it's a complicated structure, as you can see the design of it. And from when we get to that point, we'll be able to then go for our permanent financing. And until the plans are done, we're not going to be able to go for our permanent financing. And we really are hoping to get this started, late summer.
Well, I guess I, as one board member, would like to suggest that if we do grant this, we grant it with the understanding that we would not anticipate any further requests nor entertain them for further extensions.
take that into consideration in the motion. Mr. Wilcox.
Maureen.
I guess, and I don't know if Ms. McKay will be more comfortable with it, but this, unlike some of the projects the board has seen, I would like to state that the First Atlantic Corporation has been calling me over the years originally to check to see if they had a limit on their site plan approval. They were notified when the limit was established, and they have been coming in to see members of the town over the years and have been telling us about their financing issues and most recently changes that they've had to deal with in terms of originally working with private financing, then trying to get with HUD financing. And we did have a meeting this fall where they had every intention of starting construction, and I rather firmly urged them that if there was any chance that they were not going to be started in time, that they should come in and ask for an extension before there was the potential it was going to expire, rather than trying to deal with some issue after expired. So, I mean, at least in that case, they seem to have been very responsible in trying to move this project forward. It hasn't been something that's been sitting on the shelf for 3 years. So,
I'd like to add that, you know, I'd feel today uncomfortable agreeing to a one-year extension. We are coming in asking for a one-year extension, but there could be a possibility where, you know, HUD financing takes anywhere between 8 and 10 to 11 months to complete that financing process. It's a very lengthy process, and that would be a reason that if that process was delayed for whatever reason because of information that they require, that would be the only reason that we'd be coming back for an extension would be, you know, to complete that financing. But we're not anticipating that today.
Thank you.
Yep.
Any other questions? Mr. Wilcox.
I have a question. Mr. Coffin, I wasn't part of the review of the original building. Did the original building, have any of the internal uses of the building changed over the
past few years? No, they have not. Okay. It's a 60-unit congregate care facility for the elderly, and the schematics inside or the facade has not changed.
Okay.
Another question. Since you've changed architects, what has happened? The architect, I believe, had an in-house landscape architect and a consulting engineer. What is the situation with those two consultants?
The consulting engineers, to date, the site work has been completed, and the consulting has been completed. It's the architecturals of the inside of the building that have not been completed. So we're building what has been approved to date.
What would be your intentions then during construction in terms of construction administration? Who from the consultant team would be responsible for overseeing civil engineering issues and landscape issues?
The civil engineer that was the consultant would still be involved with the project. I'm not sure who those individuals were at this time. I know that BH2M was a consultant. You know, we also had, I think, Cole that did some civil work. We'd still be working with the same consultants.
Okay. Could you, along with the plans, provide information to the town planner with respect to the landscape architect? And I'm addressing that issue because planting, screening was a very big issue.
Yes.
With the neighbors, and I want to be sure that's an area that's easily overlooked and cast aside with tight budgets, and that's as important as anything else with respect to this project. And I want to be sure that there's a consultant on board willing to sign on to the plans when they finally come to the board. Another question, you're stating that you've changed your financing from private to HUD financing. Does that in any way imply a change in the rent structure or the type of people who will be qualifying for these units?
No, it's still privately fund. You know, it's still going to be a private paying facility.
There's no requirement for a certain percentage to be of moderate or lower income?
No.
That may not be an issue to the board. It may not be an issue to the neighbors. But if that is something that is changing in the application, I just want it on the record at this time. But as you stated, it's not changing. Any other questions for the board?
Perhaps we could just ask the question in the affirmative. Is there anything on the project that has changed except the architect?
The architect is the only issue that has changed today.
We're doing what's on your approved thing, on your approved set of drawings.
Thank you.
Working for an architectural firm, I'm very curious as to why there's a change, but I don't need that that's, if any of the board would like to ask the question, I'm not sure it's appropriate. Is there any other, is there anything that we need to know with respect to the change in architect, particularly where we had one that was local versus one from Virginia?
Well, Charlie Engelhardt has done architectural designs for us back now probably 15 years, and he's built nursing homes and assisted care facilities for us in Florida, Massachusetts, Maine. He's just finishing up one here in Maine for us. They built one in Bangor for us. And with Charlie's substantial healthcare background for the interior design of this building, we felt it imperative to have somebody as knowledgeable as Charlie to design this to make sure it meets the elderly requirements of what the elderly expected.
Is there any professional relationship with the previous architect? Are they in any way an architect of record? Are they responsible for conceptual design and you're just doing the construction documents, or are they free and clear of this whole project at this point?
I believe they are free and clear at this point.
If it's anything other than that, would you let Maureen know so that, just for the record, because this is a request for extension, that we want to be sure that who's ever involved in this process remains involved and is aware that they're involved in some capacity?
Yes.
Any other questions? Do I have a motion? Mr. Edsel?
Mr. Chair. I have a motion for the board to consider findings of fact. Number one, the First Atlantic Corporation is requesting a one-year extension of its site plan approval for the Elizabeth Heights 60-unit Congregate Care Project proposed off Scottsdale Road. Number two, the Elizabeth Heights project was granted site plan approval by the planning boards on January 22, 1991. Number three, subsequent amendments to the zoning ordinance established a one-year time limit for site plan approval and a deadline of February 1995. For previously approved site plans. Number four, the applicant has provided financial and construction schedule information which supports the extension of site plan approval. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and the materials previously approved and the facts presented, the request of the First Atlantic Corporation for a one-year extension to January 22, 1996 of site plan approval for Elizabeth Heights, a 60-unit congregate care project located off Scott Dyer Road, be granted.
A motion, and you would second it?
Second.
Any further discussion on the motion? I have a question for the town planner. I believe our packet, did our packet include the financial proof?
There was a letter from the applicant which stated there were financial and construction drawing issues, and that was what I was referencing.
Okay. Thank you. Motions, had a motion and second. All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
That concludes. Oh, well, not yet.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Before we get on anything else, the question of the planner, of the middle school, elementary school plans, were the any tree preservation requirements for the area in front of the historical structure? I remember that there were, it was tree preservation requirements for the, like the mall area where the monument used to be, with the considerable amount of parking of fairly heavy equipment and vehicles around the trees.
I can check that.
If you could check that for me, please. It's a crucial issue that some fairly good-sized trucks now being parked over the root system of the tree. If we're trying to save those, we won't. Thank you.
Any other discussion this evening's meeting? A motion for adjournment?
So moved.
All those in favor? Thank you. Is there any more?